morning, everybody. It is March 18th. We are here in the club. As you can see, we got a nice crowd today, and we have got all kinds of videos to share. So let's get started. The first video we are going to share today apparently needs no introduction, so I'm just going to show it.
Let me be a traveling man. Go on a beat. Look at me, I'll be gone. And you can love me if you want to. Never I do declare. When I get restless, yeah, you know I got to move somewhere. Cause I'm rolling out of baby. Anywhere's my
All right. And you expect other people to show their videos after that?
I know.
Well, the most important question is, was there any alcohol involved in the shooting of this video?
No, but my gummies are missing.
Well, what do we think of that? Obviously, from the layout, you enjoyed it.
You know, I noticed the audio was off in the beginning, but then it somewhere about halfway through it caught up. I know the original clip that Doug has.
Okay, so did you guys play the audio track and then lay the video track on top of it in the process of making it?
We had a speaker on top of the windshield inside.
So you could hear it?
Okay.
And Todd did all the rest.
So lip syncing.
Yep.
Yeah, it was at first it was off a little bit in the beginning. Yep. It'd be interesting to see when you were cutting this together, if somehow you're just a little bit off.
Yeah.
So
I never noticed. I was too busy laughing.
Well, there's that too.
Yeah.
No, it was well done. I think part of the fun of that too is knowing you two.
Yeah,
that makes it even more entertaining.
So where did you get that hat?
That's my steampunk hat.
Yeah, sure,
my whole steampunk costume.
Well, it was perfect. The other one that reminded me, that was funny, was with Doug wearing the hard hat and the sunglasses. He kind of reminded me of Joe Walsh, because he'll do that sometimes in our concerts. He's got a hard hat on or something. So. Okay. Well, that was good. Does anybody have anything else on that? It is a hard act. Well, that's why I'm going to let Todd follow with the video. Todd has, if you've been to Showtime, you've seen Todd does these little 5-minute intros to Showtime just to kind of get the thing started. And it's a history. It's basically a history lesson. And so anyway, Todd's got the latest version. So tell us about this latest version, Todd.
So this version, season 1, episode 4, is the early stars, the first stars of Hollywood.
Yeah.
Okay, let's check it out.
Caesar of Nolus, Emperor of the World. Thank you.
Okay, fellas.
Hold on. Wait, please, Miss Lunt.
Of your eternal youth.
Well, I just take natural food. I will not have poison food. I don't like it. It's not good for anybody.
Just one more question. It's an official question.
You can leave in a taxi. If you can't get a taxi, you can leave in a huff. If that's too soon, you can leave in a minute and a huff. You know you haven't stopped talking since I came here? You must have been vaccinated with a phonograph needle.
I am Sam Grunion, private eye at your service. Secrecy is my motto. I never tell. You will notice even my business card has nothing on it.
Are you single?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I hope I'm correct in guessing you're not engaged. Am I correct?
Yes.
Are you busy tonight?
Yes.
All right. What do we think of that?
Well, I only knew one of them.
Well, that's okay. What do you think of his production in terms of his research and his clips that he finds?
You didn't do that in 5 minutes.
No.
About how long does it take you, do you think, to do one of those in terms of the research and then the production?
I'm probably putting in 15, 20 hours.
I bet.
Yeah.
I think probably the research takes the more time than anything else.
Yeah. And then downloading, I'm not happy with some of the videos that I downloaded. I mean, I just couldn't get good enough resolution on them for some reason.
Yeah.
It wasn't allowing me to download like 1080s. I mean, some were with 360, 740s.
Oh, sure. Well,
and everything.
Well, is that off of YouTube?
Yep.
Well, at some point, YouTube downsizes their stuff. You can start at 1080 or 4K, and 5 or 6 years down the road or whenever it is, they'll downsize it like to 480. And then at some point, then when they really go down, they go down to 360 and 240.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I mean, that's, I don't know how many years down the road that would be. That might be 20 years down the road. But yeah, that was something that's old. Short of having the DVD or, you know, something of the original movie.
But the original was probably not that good to begin with.
Well, certainly you think of the ones in the 20s, probably not all that great.
Yeah.
But
and the old film, the spectacles would wear on it.
Mm-hmm.
So there was a built-in jitter almost that was caused by the fact that film didn't always line up with so don't expect too much out of it.
Yeah. Now, are you going to do this next year? For Showtime. What's that?
That's the plan.
Okay.
But to work on it over the summer.
Well, I was going to say. And have you thought about what your topics might be, or that's too far off?
No, I have thought about it because there are just so many different ways to go. So there's, I haven't picked the five that I'm going to do.
Okay.
But I have a direction that I'm going with it. And I talked to Phil about a few things back there. And got some suggestions from him. So
good.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, I think it's just, it's really a nice way to start Showtime.
Yeah.
And it kind of gives people just a little bit, like Gene said, he knew one of the five. I didn't know any of the five right out of the box.
I knew.
Well, no, I knew after they said names, but meaning when they first started. So at some point, I think it's nice that you're doing this in terms of just, this is adding so much more to the presentation of Showtime. It also shows, hey, if you come to the Multimedia Club, you can do some videos like this too. We'll help you work on that. Yes, sir.
One very minor grammatical issue is one minute versus 1 minute.
Oh, okay. Did he?
Yeah.
Plural.
He could consider mega singular, but minor.
No, well, that's
good
to know. Todd had shared the video with me. And there was a couple of technical things that
I still saw them on the big screen.
Yeah. There was one capitalization on Groucho's
life.
He had a big eye in there. But did you fix that?
Yeah, I fixed that.
Okay. So anyway. All right.
I'm waiting for the hotties of the silver screen.
Well, you might have to be his consultant on that. Gene's top five hotties of the silver screen. How's that? And did you know any of those hotties, by the way?
Personally. I'm not that old. Oh,
okay. Does anybody have anything else on that? All right. Well, thank you, Todd. Great job. I'm looking forward to, and showtime is the 9th?
The 9th.
Okay.
Yes.
9th of April.
Yes.
So that'll be wonderful. Let me see here. The second Brighton Beach video.
Yeah, that's just a still picture from on a really bright sunny day in the winter in Duluth at the beach. And I took a picture of this little piece of ice and then played with Pan and Zoom to see what I could do, how close I could get, and, you know, kind of look at it in great detail. So it's not a very exciting thing, but yeah, I learned a lot doing it.
Oh, and a quick question for you. Was the, when you were playing, trying to get close, was that when you shot these photos or in editing?
It's just one photograph.
Oh, this is all just one photograph.
Yeah, and I got as close as I could with my iPhone.
Okay.
You know, but not overly close to lose it.
Okay.
Well, and yeah, it was just a curiosity to see how far into it can I get.
Sure.
Yeah.
Cool. All right, let's check it out. Okay. What do we think of that?
That's utterly amazing. if anybody says, I just shot that on my phone, then they need to watch this because she's zoomed in a gazillion times. There's no pixelation. There's none of those little colored lines. I don't know what you call that. It's perfect. I mean, unbelievably good.
Well, I would agree. You know, the thing that we don't, especially if we're thinking of still photography, our phones as a still photo or our digital camera as a still image, our resolution is so big, you're maybe anywhere from, let's say, 3,000 pixels wide to maybe 5 or 6,000 pixels wide. Well, we're editing at 1080. That means you can really go in on that image and still not lose any of that detail, which is absolutely amazing, especially the opening sequence. That very first shot was, I was like, oh my God, that, if I play just a little bit of that again, or just show that, as you got in closer and closer, yeah. I was like,
yeah. I was waiting for it to pixelate to fall apart.
Look at how beautiful that is. I mean, it's gorgeous.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I was wondering, how big is that piece of ice?
It was about this big.
Oh, okay. It is that small.
Inch and a half.
I was thinking it might be real small, but.
Wow.
And then what is it? It was extremely bright that day. You know, the sky was super clear and lots of sun. It was noon, about noon. So, it's just the maximum light.
Nice. Definitely. Well, there's contrast. Right. There's a little shadow and stuff, which gives it some pop.
Uh-huh.
You know, they always, just as a photography thing, if you shoot on an overcast day, the light's very flat. There's no texture or shape to objects.
Mm-hmm.
Well, shoot on a bright sunny day like we've got here, and you get this contrast and this sharpness, the edges just pop. It really makes your photos, so much more dynamic.
Mm-hmm.
I really like the music.
Yeah.
I thought the music was perfect.
For icy music.
Did you do a search and type in icy music?
Yeah, it was free music from YouTube.
Okay.
I went to YouTube to their library and looked for something cold and icy.
Nice. Well, beautiful. Does anybody have anything else on that? Okay, I like the idea of going out and just doing a little test like that and having a little fun. Play,
The closing shot, the only thing, and maybe it was there and I missed it. It would have been nice to see that little piece of ice go out to the ice flow to see in relation how big that chunk that you were looking at was in relation to the last shot that you
had. Yeah, there wasn't any perspective there. And I think the thing that made me want to do it to begin with was I wanted to see it closer. And
sure.
I can always see things so close.
Sure.
So kind of the idea was to see how far you can get into it.
But it would have been nice to give it a relationship
to the size.
The actual flow or whatever. Yeah.
Also remind me why I'm here instead of Michigan.
Smart man. Okay. Is anybody else on that?
Yeah, a couple of thoughts on the motion part of it. At one point there, you're panning up, and then you turn around and pan down.
Tilting.
Sorry. Thank you, Bill. I'm old, I forget. If you cut that and cross-dissolve between those, it would be smoother.
Cross-dissolve. It would have been.
Mentally caused me a problem, that one. And there was one fast pan you had, too, which was out of sync with the rest of it, but just technical stuff like that.
Yeah, no, that's I noticed it too.
Okay,
but I didn't do it.
No.
That's a great way though. With a still photo, like Larry's saying, you can move it from different directions and everything by use that little cross dissolve, and it just softens it up, and you don't have the the moving. So it just it gets rid of that.
Yeah.
It keeps that movement all the same, so to speak. Okay. Well done. Very nice to see that. Gene, you got the sound test.
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
Last time I showed this little video clip, and I got some negative, no, it's not right. I got some constructive criticism. About the sound, it had a bass rumble in it. You
okay.
Know, I found out later it was because where the lapel mic was located. If I put it on the collar of the shirt, I don't get that. But if I put it down closer to your throat, I get that rumble in there.
Okay.
So I was going to record it over again with a different microphone. But I thought, no, wait a minute. I got this Da Vinci thing, and it's supposed to do all kinds of wonderful stuff. Let me get into it and see if I can correct that sound without re-recording it. And so this is my take a look at it and play this.
Okay.
It's just a couple minutes long. It took the rumble right out.
Oh, good. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, let's check it out.
You know? Yeah.
I'm Gene Camarmi. I'm the educational chair for the Green Valley Recreation Photography Club. Lately, I have received many requests from club members to offer a class on using an Android phone as a camera. I thought I'd just go to my repository of all knowledge, YouTube, and find a video on using an Android phone as a camera. I was wrong. Really wrong. Oh, I found some videos, but many were made by people whose native language is not English, and therefore they were very difficult to understand. And most all of the YouTube video creators had no pedagogical skills. With that in mind, I decided to create a video for the photography club. There's one problem. Because Android is open source, camera manufacturers have adapted the phone camera programs to their hardware. That means the camera app on every Android phone is not identical. So we're going to ask you to put a new app on your phone. Open Camera is the name of the app. It will turn your phone into a DSLR and it will allow us to standardize instruction for a quick class. So pause this video now and install Open Camera on your Android phone before you go any further.
This is the introduction to
Open
Camera. Okay. And rather me stumble over the introduction each time, it was a lot easier to record it, and then it's always consistent.
Sure.
But it took the rumble that was in there out. There was a bass rumble in there,
yeah,
in the original all the way through. Show the little JPEG file, and this is in DaVinci. And what I really had to work to find this.
Oh.
I mean, I'm going to be honest with you. DaVinci is so complicated. This is in the sound editor on DaVinci Fairlight. Okay. And you go to, I highlighted the track, the soundtrack. I went to the DaVinci, and I went to Fairlight. And then I went up to, on the upper left-hand side, you go up to effects, and I went down to dialogue processor. Now you're five levels into DaVinci to find this damn thing, you know. But it's there, and that dial that says D-Rumble.
Mm-hmm.
I turned
in. I have a question for you.
Yeah.
Do you think your voice sounded good there?
No.
It was terrible.
You know,
I thought the talent was great. You did a great job. But this equalization process that you went through here destroyed the soundtrack.
Did it?
Yes.
Yeah. You know, the one thing I would just say is that when I hear you talk, you've got a little bit more bass in your voice.
So I took too much to rumble up.
Well, but here's the other goodie that I would say too. And this goes back to photography, days of photography. You get it right in camera, you shoot it the way you want it to be shot, you don't get in and Photoshop the hell out of it. Unless, to me, doing something like that is a fix if you have no choice. So going to Phil's point, okay, if this is the only thing you can do and you got to fix it, you're going to try to go in there. You're going to alter it.
No, I would believe the original.
Well, no. Well, just meaning that you're going to try to fix. The audio isn't as good as you would like it to be.
I understand.
As an example, when I'm out shooting and I'm outside and I've got a little wind noise, I'm trying to minimize that if I can. If I can't, then there's a filter that I can use.
Right, right.
It doesn't, it works, but yet it doesn't. So,
gee, we lost all the dynamics in your voice.
Okay.
With this equalization.
I was just teasing with you. I understand what you're saying. Yeah. Yeah. I've lost the tonality in there.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And there are no highs whatsoever.
Yes. I have another thing, which is strictly photography. The reflection in their glasses really bothered me because it kept coming and going and coming and going.
Yeah.
There are ways.
I just have to change the lights. That's probably a box light.
Or sometimes you can tilt your glasses just a little bit.
Yeah. No, it's probably a box.
Actually, what it is it looks like it's the monitor. Are you reading off the computer?
Yeah.
If I'm looking right there.
Yeah, you're looking at,
I'm seeing the monitor.
Monitor,
So maybe the idea would be to print out.
Or I can use a separate.
Turn it, so.
And now I have a separate teleprompter that works on the on my Kindle.
Oh, does it?
Yeah, it's true.
And does it?
That parent teleprompter.
Do you have any issues with your glasses?
No,
with that?
I should have used the Kindle.
Oh, okay.
Because it's a little bit lower.
Okay.
It would come in about here.
Okay.
Can I learned the teleprompter. Glasses, Gene?
Pardon?
Can you see it without the glasses?
The Kindle?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, it's old.
That man, that's a lot. You haven't seen it?
Oh, my God, you guys. No, I just said I'd play with you, you know, to
share
with The other thing I have for everybody, I got in today. Da Vinci. I was going to use a couple expletive deletions every night. It's such a powerful program. It's almost scary. I mean, it really is. So I mentioned several people in here were interested. So Jim bought a book. I kiddingly told him he paid $50 for it. Close. It's just it's a beginner's guide to Da Vinci, and it's about this thick. I'm not kidding. So I'm, you know, being the tightwad that I am, I said I bet they have that for my Kindle. So I went on and sure, God, they had it for the Kindle for like $6.99. So I bought it, you know. And then I was talking to a friend of mine. She said, well, you know, it's free if you go to Black Magic. And she said, it's really hard to find. And she gave me all the directions. So I went and got a PDF copy, and I emailed it to all of you this morning. Everybody who's registered in the SIG, you got an email. Yeah, you can just then download it. And the PDF works great. You can read the book. It's really nice. They're concise lessons, and they have practice files with them and everything. All
nice.
And if you do the whole thing, when you get done with the whole book, you can go to Da Vinci, and you can take an online test. And they'll certify you a Da Vinci or whatever.
I don't think I can live that long and go through.
Me either.
Wonderful.
But I do send it to this.
Yeah. Well, thanks for doing that. That's
everybody
very nice.
Can do it so much.
Well, certainly
there's a class online on Da Vinci, and it says everything you ever wanted to know about Da Vinci. It's 3 hours and 12 minutes.
Oh, wow.
Is that any good?
I think
he admitted.
You know, there's lots of stuff out there on YouTube, and we direct people to YouTube if you're trying to learn a new software like that. And the thing that helps is if you can have your computer and then maybe have an iPad or another monitor or laptop or something. And then you can be looking at the video and then stop it, then try it. If it doesn't work, then go back and watch that video again, that little section of the video. And it's a great way to figure out, instead of trying to stop the video, and now you got to go to the software on your computer, and it's a big pain in the butt.
And if you watch the YouTube videos, the instructional ones, it also gives you a whole lot of ideas on what not to do when you're making your own videos, because very few of these people that do the instructional videos have a great degree of educational skill. So you'll find they go really fast, they push buttons they don't explain, and it looks like they're not working off a script.
Right.
And as you watch a few of them, you know, you realize these people are incredibly knowledgeable.
Yes.
The problem is,
the production of that video share.
Way too fast.
Yeah.
Well, they skip over things. They understand it. And as a beginner, you may not understand it. And so it definitely, if there's a good teacher doing that video, then they really explain it well, and it makes a big difference. Okay. Well, thank you for doing that. Well, good. Well, I think we have one more video for today, and this is my video. And what this is, those of you may or may not know, Danny, our president, took a walk last summer in Spain, Camino de Santiago. And it's about 500 miles. He did it in 31 days or 32 days, something like that. Long story short, we're having a board meeting a few months ago, and Danny says, I'm going to be doing a PowerPoint presentation at the social that we're going to have on April 8th.
Yep.
So if you want to see this video in entirety, you'll have to come on the 8th for the world premiere. Anyway, I said, well, we should, when Danny said, well, I'm going to do a PowerPoint, I thought, well, that's going to be boring. Let's put something together. Well, seriously, PowerPoint sucks.
There's death by PowerPoint.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So anyway, I said, well, we should, as a group, multimedia group, we should put this together. Well, of course, I got busy and I don't have time to screw around. So I'm working this in on my own. So what we did is, after we had the volunteer luncheon a couple weeks ago, we set up in here, we recorded, Todd helped me, we recorded Danny. We put him on camera. Originally, I wasn't going to put him on camera. I was just going to have him do audio. Mm-hmm. But I thought, let's put him on camera. And so what we did is, he has an opening, and then he has a closing, about 5 minutes for each of those. And then we go through in the video, we're going to go through some of the days. There's certain days that were special to him or emotional or whatever. So we had him talk about those days. I would say out of the 30 plus days, he's only talking about 10 of the days or so. The other days, we'll just have a couple of pictures and stuff. So in this video, this open that you're going to see, it's Danny talking about this walk and the history of the walk. Then it goes into, I'm just going to show you a minute of how this is going to start in terms of the trip. And you'll see Danny talking and then some B-roll, some photos that he took. So anyway, let's check it out.
The Camino de Santiago, also known as the Way of St. James, is a network of ancient pilgrimage routes that lead to Santiago de Compostela in northwestern Spain. I walked the Camino Frances, the French route. It begins in the town of Saint-Jean, Pierre-de-Port, France, about 4 miles from the border of Spain, and stretches almost 500 miles across northern Spain to Santiago de Compostela. I walked it in 31 days with 1 day of rest along the way. The Camino has been a pilgrimage route for more than 1,000 years, and there is evidence that there was a route in pre-Christian times. According to Christianity, one of the original apostles, Santiago, also known as Saint James, walked the route while spreading religion throughout the Iberian Peninsula of Spain. The Camino grew in popularity in the Middle Ages, with more than 250,000 pilgrims traveling along the Camino each year. Due to the Black Death, Protestant Reformation, and political unrest in the 16th century, only a few hundred pilgrims walk the Camino. Today, it attracts pilgrims from all over the world. In 2023, over 445,000 pilgrims, or peregrinos as they are known in Spanish, finished the Camino, an all-time high. I was one of them. You may be aware that when Catholics go to confession, they atone for their sins through some form of penance, usually prayers. In medieval times, the Camino pilgrimage was deemed to be a suitable penance for sins. In addition, pilgrimages were imposed as judicial punishment for a crime. A prisoner was given the choice, prison time or, accompanied by a guard, walk the Camino wearing a heavy backpack. Most pilgrims walk for religious or spiritual reasons or as a personal challenge. I did it as a personal challenge, although some days for me, it became emotional. The document that certifies your journey is called a Compostela. To earn a Compostela, you must complete at least 100 kilometers by foot or horseback, or 200 kilometers by bicycle on any of the routes that make up the Camino. And you must be able to prove that distance covered. The credential used to document your walk is referred to as a pilgrim's passport. It must be stamped twice a day for the final 100 kilometers if walking, or on horseback, or 200 kilometers if by bicycle. The shell you see is a symbol of the Camino. Over the centuries, it has taken on a variety of meanings, metaphorical, practical, and mythical. During medieval times, it was more a proof of completion than a symbol. It is typically attached to your backpack, and it signifies that you are a peregrino or a peregrina. On this trail, you will see this rendition of the shell as a way marker to guide you on the route. This is a map of the French Way, or route, as it starts in Saint-Jean-Pied-de-Port, France. You can see it on the upper right corner, 4 miles from the border of Spain. While on the Camino, it is common to hear people wish each other a buen camino. It means good way, good journey. It is a wish for a safe, healthy, and enjoyable physical trip, as well as a fruitful spiritual journey. It's heard every day along the Camino. So the first day up the Pyrenees, I started in the dark. Of course, I couldn't sleep the night before, and it soon got light, and I could see how beautiful the climb was. It was pretty much a paved road, but I was told at the pilgrim's office when I checked in the day before that when I got to the cross, I was supposed to get off the road and go on the dirt path. Well, about 2 miles up, it got very cloudy and misty, and I couldn't see more than 25 feet in front of me. About 4 miles up, there's an albergue. A lot of the people would go that far, then wait, stay the night, and then go the rest of the way. Not me. This was a 15-mile day. It took me 10 hours to get across. So as I climbed the mountain, I saw a arrow pointing to the right on the road with a C. And I thought, there's a cross. I walked off the road and I saw the cross. I couldn't see much further than the cross because of the fog. I mean, it was thick. I was walking in soup. I forgot that I was supposed to get off the road. But when I was in the peregrino's office, they marked the left side of the road where the cross was. This was on the right side, so I thought, this is not the cross. So I went back up.
Okay, that's a start. What do you think?
Wow.
I think it's going to be really good.
Yeah.
To me, the interesting thing about this was Danny and I, when we started talking about this, I said, okay, well, let's come to the club. And he had photos and he'd laid it out day by day. And so I said, well, let's go through, let's see what you've got. Because initially my thought was, this is only going to be like a 10 or 15 minute thing. Yeah. It's just going to be a slideshow in a sense. And we're going to have some text on there. Well, Danny and I were here for 3 hours going over this trip. And I'm taking notes and I am just amazed at what he went through on this walk. And so from there, I said, well, we've got to, you know, record some of this stuff. So meaning we're going to record your opening and we're going to record your end. And then at some point when we started doing it, Todd and I were doing it, and I was like, this is too good. We got to get him on camera. He's so good. So anyway, this is the start of that. I'm up to day 24, I think. We have, like I said, there's some days where Danny's on camera like that, then there's some days where he's not on camera, and it's just 3 or 4 pictures from that day. And then we also are tracking his mileage, what the hike is that day, and then how far he's gone. So anyway.
You think this is better than the PowerPoint?
Better than what? Better than the PowerPoint. Well, if it's not, I suck.
Did he have the images or did you find the illustrations?
No, I looked out on the internet for stuff. So basically in that opening, some of the stuff, I had to do some searching to try to find some things. But then when it comes to the photos, they're his photos. And like I said, he and I will have to go through this because he has stuff in folders from each day. But I have to make sure that, okay, what I'm showing is exactly from that day. But anyway, I think it's really going to be nice. It's right now, I bet you this is going to be 40 minutes. We would have probably have to do a little trimming on this, get it knocked down. It's not like we're going to knock it down to 15 minutes. But were you, as he's talking about that first day, were you compelled by that?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay, good.
Yeah, because, you know, when he first brought it up to the board,
yep,
this PowerPoint, in my mind, I'm sitting there thinking, okay, on day one, we're 50 yards from the intersection.
Yes.
And don't walk.
Yes.
And here's where we make our turn at the intersection of walk and don't walk. And this is so, so much better.
Okay.
I mean, it really gets into the mysticism and the motivation and everything for him to be doing this.
And I think there's a lot more to, this will be a lot more valuable than you're anticipating. We're going to show this at the social, but I think the finished product needs to be shared to a wider audience than the social.
Oh, it will be.
You know, I would like to see it at a GBR-sponsored event and have a movie night and show it.
It'd be great. Well, I know he said there's some travel group that wants to see this when it's all said and done. And so anyway, I normally, as you know, I preach like, keep it short, keep them wanting more. And as I'm doing this, I'm like, oh, God, this is really getting long, but it's so interesting. So hopefully we don't have people walking out at the end because they're like, this is horrible. I think Danny's very compelling.
I think people are going to want to see how it ends.
Yes, yeah. Exactly.
So when we were recording it the other day,
yeah,
we had some background
yep.
issues.
Yep.
Were you able to take those out? Or
there was a little one in there that you heard. There was just a little thump.
Yeah.
And I cleaned up some. I haven't gotten to a point where I heard other stuff yet. I think we're okay.
Yeah, we think it was coming from downstairs.
Yeah, there was something was going on.
Someone was running a sweeper or something. That came on, and then they were moving around tables.
Yeah, but it didn't, we just had that little bit and I cleaned up some of it. So anyway, this has been a lot of fun to do. I always talk about us doing projects as a group. And at some point I'd like to do more of this with the group and have us get together, have a concept, shoot it, and then come in here and then do editing.
That'd be cool.
But I can't even tell you already how many hours I've spent. It's probably 40 or 50 hours. And I'm probably going to be, by the time it's all said and done, it'll probably be at least 80 or 90 hours of editing to get this done.
Yep.
But I'm so proud of Danny for what he did. And with him talking about it last summer, because he did this in August, and leading up to it, he and I were talking about how much he was walking each day to get ready for this. And I think on the thing, he had one day that they did 19 miles. Most of the days was around 15. Well, go out and walk 10 miles.
Go ahead.
See how you feel.
Yeah.
And also to think that he's 75 and doing that. Oh, my God. So anyway, so that's the video. And we'll, so April 8th. If you can, you're going to be in town, sign up for the dinner, and they're going to have this video, and I think we're going to have a nice goodie.
Yeah. I wanted to add one other thing to it that I found interesting, because my part in this, when we were recording it the other day, was actually to sit in a chair off to the side, and you haven't shown any of Danny on camera yet.
No.
But what was interesting was, because his story is very compelling. And I'm listening to the story and I'm reacting to the story. Now, I'm not verbally, just my facial expressions. And that caused him to then create facial expressions and everything that, and Kevin and I talked about this afterwards, that that's one of the reasons why when you are interviewing, wanting to have someone else sitting there and hearing the story and feeling it and everything, and getting the person who's actually being recorded to show just something other than like I'm sitting here reading a book and everything. So it's just something to keep in mind when you're setting up, you know, interviews and things like that, that it's really a three-person.
Well, it definitely is. I think, and that's the thing that really was helpful. I'm trying to see if I can find one of the stills here as I'm talking that is important, because if I'm watching the picture, but I'm also watching the sound levels. And so I'm trying to make sure that all of that is good. Well, I can't be sitting here looking at that. And I want Danny talking off camera because it makes it more comfortable. So Todd, him talking to Todd, just like this, it's somebody to talk to. It's somebody to tell the story. And we're just happen to be in the room as photography. So let me see. Here we go. So we had background. We have we've got the video camera here. I've got the external monitor, so I'm sitting here watching that. We have five lights. We've got three of these little lights. So I've got a little light coming from the front on him. I've got a nice side light which is lighting up him. I've got the another side light here, which has a little scrim on it, we call it, to soften up the light. So it's a nice, soft, pleasing look. We have a light on the background, which gives that nice glow behind him. And then there's a light behind that's kicking him, the back of his head. So if I put that video up again, you can see that with the just that little bit of backlight, just to give him some edge. And then the soft little fill from the side, and then a little fill from the front. Yeah. So anyway, and the one thing that was funny is when I showed up that day, I had a whole cart full of equipment. And Danny said, "What's this for?" "This is for you." He says, "Do you really need all that?" And I said, "Yes, because if we're going to do this, we're not doing this half-ass." Seriously, we're going to go all the trouble of sitting here recording. Why am I just going to have my iPhone?
Yeah.
Let's put up a background. Let's do some nice lighting. This isn't a paying gig, so we can take time. Where you going? So anyway, April 8th, come to the social. Sign up. You can sign up online. You register. You can get your order, your food. And it's BYOB, and I'm definitely going to bring an adult beverage. Oh. You should, too.
3 weeks from today.
3 weeks from today. Holy, is it 3 weeks? Wow. Okay. All right.
That was more for you.
Yeah, that's true. All right. So next, don't worry. I'll have it done. Anyway, we will not meet next week, so we will meet in 2 weeks. I will be here. You'll get an email from me on Sunday reminding you not to come, because there won't be a thing next Monday. The 24th, I believe. Yeah, 24th. Anyway, so we'll meet in April, and away we go. All right. Everybody have a great day.
One thing left.
Oh, go ahead.
I'm the front man for Doug.
Oh.
He's the background guy. He wanted me to do some stuff here. So
he's got to show the goodies.
Yeah, well, kind of. With Pod... Kevin,
yes.
Come up on either side of me. Aside from Gene, I guess I'm about the oldest guy in the club here, in the multimedia side anyway. I took over the multimedia from a guy called Jim McLean.
Oh, yeah.
And,
many years ago.
More, actually.
A little more. Okay.
So I've seen a lot of people go through and... Yeah, squeeze in so you're in the picture.
Squeeze in.
I don't have that bad of a bad breath, do I?
You're fine. We can't see us, but that's okay.
So the point that Doug wanted to make was that you guys have contributed a lot to this. You're following a long succession of people. And it's great what the multimedia group is doing. You know, it's way more active than the rest of the club, to my impression, but I don't go to the rest of the club, so I don't know. It's a biased opinion.
I think you're right.
I have many biased opinions.
You're right.
I'm right about that too.
Oh yeah.
Biased opinion. That's right. Anyway, so this is from Doug. So
oh my
Evan.
Holy cow, check this out.
This is for Todd.
Oh.
So
all right. Well, this is very neat.
Well done, you guys. Well,
thank you.
What you're doing.
Well, thank you. Oh, God.
Hold them up so we can get a picture
there.
Everybody's autographs.
It's very cool.
Yeah.
Thanks, Doug. Yes, thank you very much for doing that. And, you know, I would just quickly say I appreciate you all coming. We have our snowbirds that aren't here during the wintertime, or that are here during the wintertime, which is great. In the summer, we've got our diehards that are here. But look at how many people we have come out to this. If we look at all the other SIGs, like Larry said, they don't have 20 people, 30 people like we do. So that's a testament, though, to you as well as participants to come out here, create your videos, share them. It's huge. So thank you for doing that.
Thank you for showing up when I'm the substitute.
Yeah. Thank you for not harassing Todd too much as the substitute.
Or treating the substitute.
That's it.
Hey, when I watched the one with Danny, maybe next year we can look at doing some like demonstrations, hands on, like setting up a lighting display.
Sure.
With our equipment, so that then our members could come in.
Sure.
Grab the equipment out of the closet and set up an interview. You know.
We could definitely do that.
Yeah.
That's why I Sandy does that every Wednesday.
He does a little bit of that with his studio.
He does a lot of lighting, studio lighting. He can teach you that too.
Well, the good thing about it, I think, with Sandy's also, he's using continuous lighting, which we would use for video.
Yeah.
So that makes a big difference versus using strobe lighting, which wouldn't apply to our video. So, okay.
Yeah. So back when Phil and I were doing the multimedia for how many years, Phil?
Who knows?
Five. For year after year, there were videos he and I would produce. And maybe one other person during the year. And nowadays, we got everybody producing stuff. It's fantastic to see. You know, it's a real growth industry. And since I'm so enthused about it, I'm delightful that other people see the same enthusiasm. So,
I agree with that.
Appreciate your help.
Yes.
Especially on the audacity and the sound of things.
Yeah.
You've been a big help to me.
Yeah.
Well, I'd say that's the other beauty of this group is that we try to help each other. And if somebody's got a question about software and I don't know, Todd might know, or somebody else in the group, like the Audacity thing, Larry's worked with it more than any of us have, seemingly. So it's like, there's our expert. So anyway, I'm appreciative that we do have people that are willing to share their knowledge like that. So thank you. All right.
Okay.
We're out of here. See you in 2 weeks. Thank you, everybody.